Hello, and welcome to this video on carbon dating. My name is Adam Baldwin. I'd like to begin this video by going over a quick visual graphic that I made on the right side of your screen. Carbon dating is a relatively simple process, and it begins in the sky. Cosmic rays from the sun will collide with atoms in the upper atmosphere, and they produce energetic neutrons. These energetic neutrons then collide with nitrogen-14 atoms to produce a carbon-14 atom and a proton. Carbon-14 acts very similar to carbon-12, and it oxidizes in the atmosphere to carbon dioxide, where it is then transported to the lower atmosphere, where it is then taken in by plants during photosynthesis. Organisms that eat these plants absorb carbon-14 into all their tissues, including their bones. Carbon-14 undergoes a process that returns it to nitrogen-14 called beta decay. Carbon-14 has a half-life of 5,730 years. This number will become important for us when we're going over math problems later on in the video. By simply measuring how much carbon-14 is left inside of a sample, scientists can determine its age. Before we go on, we can talk a little bit about the history of carbon dating. Willard Libby was a professor of chemistry at the University of Chicago, and he began his research on radiocarbon dating in 1945. However, in 1946, he then proposed a new method for dating organic materials by measuring the content of carbon-14. He would call this radiocarbon dating. Theoretically, if one could detect the amount of carbon-14 in an object, one could establish that object's age using the half-life or the rate of decay of the isotope. In 1946, Libby proposed this groundbreaking idea in the journal Physical Review. Willard Libby was inspired by a physicist from the New York University named Sergei Korff. In 1939, Sergei discovered that neutrons were produced during the bombardment of the atmosphere by cosmic rays. Korff predicted that the reaction between these neutrons and nitrogen-14, which predominates in the atmosphere, would produce carbon-14. Libby realized that carbon-14 in the atmosphere would eventually find its way into living matter and would then become tagged with that radioactive isotope. The concept of radiocarbon dating focused on measuring the carbon content of discrete organic objects, but in order to prove the idea, Libby would have to understand the Earth's carbon system. Carbon-14 can enter the Earth's carbon system by a process we just recently discussed. Cosmic rays enter the atmosphere, they cause molecules to break apart. These resulting high energy neutrons can then collide with nitrogen-14 in the atmosphere. And if we look, nitrogen has 7 protons, but when the neutron collides with it, it knocks one off. The resulting atom only has 6 protons, and that makes it carbon. So now we have a carbon atom that's heavier than its normal carbon-12. This radioactive isotope has a half-life, once again, of 5,730 years, and the process whereby it turns back into nitrogen-14 is called beta decay. Radiocarbon dating would be most successful if two important factors are true: that the concentration of carbon-14 in the atmosphere had been constant for thousands of years, and that carbon-14 moved readily through the atmosphere, biosphere, oceans, and other reservoirs, in a process known as the carbon cycle. In the absence of any historical data concerning the intensity of cosmic radiation, Libby just simply assumed that it had been constant. And for the sake of this class, we'll also assume that carbon-14 in the atmosphere has remained constant. He reasoned that the state of equilibrium must exist wherein the rate of carbon-14 production was equal to its rate of decay, dating back millennia. For the second factor, it would be necessary to estimate the overall amount of carbon-14 and compare this against all other isotopes of carbon. Based on Korff's estimation that just 2 neutrons were produced per second per square centimeter of Earth's surface, each form of carbon-14 atom, Libby calculated of just 1 carbon-14 atom per every 10 to the 12 carbon atoms on Earth. In other words, about 1 in a trillion molecules of carbon dioxide contains carbon-14. Therefore, about 1 out of every trillion molecules of CO2, which plants take in to build sugars and structural components, contains carbon-14. And this ratio will propagate it all the way through plants and animals. Libby's next task was to study the movement of carbon-14 through the carbon cycle. And what they were able to determine was that the concept of radiocarbon dating relied on the assumption that once an organism died, it would be cut off from the carbon cycle, thus creating a time capsule with a steadily diminishing carbon-14 count. Living organisms from today would have the same amount of carbon-14 as the atmosphere, whereas extremely ancient sources that were once alive, such as petroleum or coal beds, would have none left. For organic objects of intermediate ages, between a few centuries and several millennia, an age could be estimated by measuring the amount of carbon-14 present in the sample and comparing this against the known half-life of carbon-14. Unfortunately, because carbon-14 has a half-life of 5,730 years, we aren't able to measure or to date things that are over 50,000 to about 75,000 years old. So unfortunately, carbon dating won't help us to date dinosaurs, but it'll help us to date other things. For example, Libby's group, they applied this technique to test how old trees were. And we could count how old trees are by counting their annual growth rings. But comparing the data that we got from carbon-14 and the amount of growth rings that a tree had, we're able to confirm that this process was actually giving us accurate measurements. So this method would help to disprove several previously held beliefs, including the notion that civilization originated in Europe and diffused throughout the world. By dating man-made artifacts from Europe, the Americas, Asia, Africa, and Oceania, archaeologists established that civilizations developed in many independent sites across the world. Libby's work also contributed greatly to geology. By using wood samples from trees once buried under glacial ice, Libby proved that the last ice sheet in northern North America receded 10,000 to 12,000 years ago, not 25,000 years ago, as geologists had previously estimated. So as archaeologists and other scientists spent less time trying to determine artifact ages, they were able to ask more searching questions about the evolution of human behavior rather than trying to date everything. So in this class, and physics classes in general, what we tend to worry about is the math. So we're going to go a quick run through of how to do the math regarding radiocarbon dating. So the following equation that we have up at the top gives a quantitative relationship between the original number of nuclei present at time zero, so n0, and the number n at a later time. And we get the equation n, so the number of nuclei present at a later time, n equals n0 e to the negative lambda t, where e is mathematical equivalent of 2.71828, and lambda is a decay constant for the nuclei. The shorter the half-life, the larger the value of lambda, and the faster the exponential e to the negative lambda t decreases with time. This relationship between the decay constant lambda and the half-life is shown. So this comes out to the equation of lambda equals 0.693 over half-life. And we can use this equation to our advantage if we're given math problems. So for an example, if we were asked to calculate the age of the Shroud of Turin, given that the amount of carbon-14 found in its tissues is 92%. So a little bit of history of the Shroud of Turin, just because it's interesting, is the Shroud of Turin was a long piece of fabric that was purported to be the burial shroud of Jesus. This relic was first displayed in Turin in 1354 and was denounced as a fraud at that time. Its remarkable negative imprint of an apparently crucified body resembles the then-accepted image of Jesus, and so the shroud was never disregarded completely and remained controversial over the centuries. Carbon-14 dating was not performed on the shroud until 1988, when the process had been refined to the point where only a small amount of material needed to be destroyed. Samples were then tested at three independent laboratories. All three laboratories found the samples of the shroud contain 92% of carbon-14 found in living tissues, allowing the shroud to be dated. So, knowing that 92% of carbon-14 remains, that gives us the ratio of n over n naught to be 0.92. Therefore, the equation n equals n naught e to the negative lambda t can be used to determine lambda t. And we also know that the half-life of carbon-14 is 5,730 years, and so once lambda t is known, we can use the equation lambda equals 0.693 over half-life to find lambda, and then find t as requested. So here we go. So solving for this equation, we get 0.92 equals e to the negative lambda t. Then, taking the natural logarithm on both sides of the equation yields ln of 0.92 equals negative lambda t. So that negative 0.0834 equals negative lambda t. Rearranging to isolate t gives us that t equals 0.0834 over lambda. Now we can use the equation lambda equals 0.693 over half-life to solve for t. So rearranging all the values that were given, we find that t equals 690 years. Now this does not mean that the shroud is 690 years old. This means that it was it's a material from 690 years ago. So we take the year that it was tested, 1988, and we subtract 690 years. And this gives us about 1300. So our calculation is only accurate to two digits, so that year is just rounded to 1300. The values obtained at three different independent laboratories gave a weighted average of about 1320. And what this means is that the shroud, or the Shroud of Turin, is consistent with the first record of its existence and not with the period at which Jesus lived. So they were able to determine that this material was indeed a fraud. And that is how we do the math. Good luck, and